So they can't leave that apartment. You heard the news that Anderson Cooper reported. He spoke with your brother's girlfriend, who says he had been sick for a while. He was sweating overnight, sweating in the sheets. He had diarrhea. Only then did he go to the hospital emergency room where he was vomiting. He had a fever. They then sent him out. They said, go home. Gave him some antibiotics, if you will, some pain medicine, and they just let him go back. You must be deeply, your son has been in contact with him. He's now being quarantined. How old is your son?
My son is 21 years old.
What does he say to you?
Okay, when I asked him this morning and yesterday about before the announcement of Ebola, what happened to your uncle? He said, he been here fine, we all be okay. He was even trying to see if he can get a job here. And I've been calling him, when Eric was there, I call him every day. He had never told me he was sick. He left laughing, he liking music, he would play music. And what say, well, until, they said on Thursday, when he got sick, for the first time he got fever, they took him to the hospital. They went to the hospital, and then the doctor gave him some medications and said, okay, you can go home. And they sent him back home. When he came home, so from Thursday, he was okay. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, when he started getting fever again, when he looked, he began to start vomiting. That's why he went to the bathroom, vomiting in the bathroom, and when he was getting serious, that's the time they had to call 911 for him. And then when the doctor pronounced, he had Ebola.
How worried are you, Mr. Smallwood, about the potential condition of your 21-year-old son who's being quarantined inside that apartment, which really hasn't been cleaned up since your half-brother was spending the nights there sweating and potentially leaving some very contagious material in that apartment?
Well, I think at this issue now, we look to the CDC, who is responsible to get the people out of there and put it on a prevention immediate and do the best they can do to that place. Because I'm just hearing from you that this man was in the bedroom sweating and all you're saying, but all we know, the first thing was fever. He started with fever and he went to the hospital and the hospital sent him back home and gave him some medications. But on Sunday is when he started vomiting in the bathroom. When I asked my son this morning, he said he vomited in the bathroom. He only vomited in the bathroom when we call the 911 for him. That's it.
Yeah, and only now we're told the CDC is sending medical contractors to that apartment to get those sheets, those pillowcases, remove them, clean up that apartment. Are you scared about the fate not only of your 21-year-old son, but others who are there, including your brother's girlfriend and other kids, children who are there?
Oh, yes, I'm skeptical now because since you described it this way, it may make anybody skeptical. Since it was this way, and we're hearing the information that he was sweating all along, and that house had not been cleaned, and it had been quarantined there, and that's a major problem to us, to everybody. So that worried me now, yes.
So your brother, obviously, and understandably so, given the spread of Ebola in Liberia, he wanted to get out of there, and 2 weeks ago, you say, He got the visa from the U.S. Embassy in Monrovia to come to the United States. And then you say a week later he actually bought the ticket and then he flew to Brussels, to Washington Dulles International Airport, then to Dallas, Texas. I don't know if you spoke to your brother, but did he ever say to you, I got to get out of here because I'm afraid of Ebola?
No. He never even said that. He was only happy coming. Oh, I'm coming to see my son and my wife have helped me, so I'm coming to see them. I'm coming to be there. And we know it's taking a long time to come and see a family. So coming to the United States to see a family, he didn't mention nothing about Ebola. He didn't even mention about any sickness at all. He just came. He always know the family. He's coming to his wife and his son because they live here. So it was just regular and normal to visit his family and be with them. That's all we felt. And he was here, happy. We spoke enough and talking enough every day. How you coming, Eric? Okay, yeah, mama, yeah, I'm fine. I said, okay, I'm trying to find my way and come to see you guys, okay? I'll come there very soon, but I try to do something, I'll come there. Or maybe you come here too, but let me get some money, then you come to visit me in Phoenix, okay? We discuss it like that. Unless recently now they say Ebola. But I don't think he ever knew he had Ebola because, and the second thing again, I think coming from Liberia to the United States, you got to go through a lot of tests. I think he was tested in Africa, too, at the same time. He was tested there, went through his medical test, and came to the United States. And what surprised me, if he had been diagnosed for the first time to the hospital and sent him back home, with Ebola among the people. And so who should be blamed? Who? The hospital or, and my concern is, how did he get his Ebola? Is it from here or is it from Africa? That's our question right now.
Because he went to the hospital. Apparently he was in contact with a pregnant woman in Monrovia who had Ebola, wound up dying. And as you point out, he wanted to help her. He saw her collapse. He went over to help her. There's one suspicion that maybe that's how he got Ebola. But as you know, Ebola is pretty widespread right now in West Africa, including in Monrovia, the capital of Liberia. Wilfred Smallwood, we're going to stay in close touch with you. I know you're deeply concerned about your brother. You're deeply concerned about your son, 21-year-old son, who's there in that apartment. You're concerned about all the other family members and friends who may have been in contact with your brother.